Good evening, everyone. My name is Jacob, and welcome to the Free Thought Forum presented by the Pennsylvania Nonbelievers. And once again, I'm joined by Doug.
Greetings, everyone. Thanks for tuning in.
We got a bit to talk about tonight, but before we get into that, I have a couple of announcements to make. First, we finally have confirmation that we will be holding our annual winter solstice party on Saturday, December 19th. From 2 to 7 p.m. For all the details, check out our Facebook page under the Events tab for things like directions and what you can bring and what will be provided. Again, if you're wondering, yes, I will be bringing poppers, so you don't have to worry about that.
Oh, thank goodness for that.
Yes. We might get a big crowd there. We're having a couple of different free thought groups who are invited. So it should be a good time to get out with our fellow atheists and other free thinkers throughout the area. And we also want to remind you that an ongoing campaign we're going to be having is with the Secular Coalition for America called Put Kids First, which is a lobbying effort to get non-medical exemptions to vaccines repealed. Right now, anybody can there are religious and non-religious exemptions that people can get to refuse vaccines for their kids, which is causing a lot of health risk in the country, especially in Pennsylvania, where we have one of the lowest vaccination rates in the country. And as a result, we're starting to see more and more cases of measles, whooping cough, and other easily vaccine-preventable diseases that people are opting out of for really no reason. And it's especially disturbing when the non-religious exemptions are outnumbering the religious exemptions. So it's not just a religious problem. You know, religious wanting to opt out of it. It's just a lot of people pressing an anti-science agenda who are causing this medical concern. So if you want more information on that, plus any other information on the Secular Coalition for America, they're a very active lobbying group, and they have all sorts of action alerts about numerous church-state separation issues going on, because they're at times we've had as many as a dozen bills in the works in our state Congress that have threatened our constitutional rights, and it's important to stay on top of that, and it's important that we stay vocal to our representatives so that they know about there is a dissenting opinion that feels very strongly about it.
And that's not just being vocal by, you know, writing an email or sending them a letter. It's also a good idea to go to Harrisburg, walk up those Capitol steps, and look for the various politicians, your representatives, and just go in and press the flesh, say hello, like that. Hey, I'm such and such, and I think that you should change your opinion on this particular.
Well, and actually, the Secular Coalition for America will help you set up meetings with your politician and give you the resources needed to and information you need to be able to have a conversation about it, about whatever the issue is, not just this issue, but other issues as well. They'll give you a little bit of coaching on how to approach it.
But you know, you need to lend your voice to the cause.
Right. So again, that's the Secular Coalition for America, and specifically the Pennsylvania chapter. To keep in mind, if you want to engage in more activism, specifically with political lobbying. But in other news, one thing I wanted to spend a bit of time talking about is a lot of things going on in the news lately that I think we need to be discussed. It was kind of a rough November throughout the world, starting with the terrorist attacks in Paris, where a gunman open fire at a concert plus several other locations throughout Paris.
A bunch of gunmen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I think the concert in particular was targeted because the band was rather irreverent. The sad part is when something like that happens, you almost don't even have to wonder who did it anymore. Especially in Paris, because they've been the subject of a couple of attacks recently. I was just earlier this year, there was the Charlie Hebdo shooting of a satirical magazine for their mockery of Islam. And they were targeted specifically because of that. And, you know, and when something like this happens, now it's just an assumption. We're just, okay, they're going to be, ISIS or Al-Qaeda is going to be claiming responsibility for this any day now. There was also, as I was prepping for the show, there was also the California shooting that has been declared an act of terrorism, and I know, and I shouldn't say it's terrorism is definitely not confined to Muslims either. There have been a few acts of Christian terrorism lately, such as the Planned Parenthood shooting, and again with that shooting, if somebody shoots up a Planned Parenthood, you don't even have to wonder what group is responsible for that. Mm-hmm. You know, you can always kind of already know what the profile of the person is going to be, and that's one of the things too that's worth noting. I think is Christian terrorism is often downplayed or completely ignored, even though it's been prevalent throughout our history. I mean, even just recent history, like the bombing at the Atlantic Olympics was an act of Christian terrorism, or the Oklahoma City bombing, or various other acts. So, for example, some of the actions by the KKK, which is an explicitly Christian organization.
Well, say they are anyway.
Well, that's the problem. Yeah. That's actually the problem. Is whenever there's an act of Christian terrorism, the Christian leaders are very quick to disown them.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is partially to their credit to condemn this act, but it's not a condemnation like this is a terrible act, but more of, you know, this isn't what being a Christian is all about. This is not, and they try to say these are somehow not true Christians,
mm-hmm.
And it's, which is really worrisome, because actually if you look at the Bible, what some of these acts may be supported by the Bible. I mean, if you look at, say, the witch hunts, you know, that's clearly and explicitly endorsed by the Bible. As much as they don't like to admit it, you know, we can show you chapter and verse in Exodus where it says quite clearly, thou shalt not suffer a witch to live. So you can't say these sorts of things don't make people true Christians. And I mean, or we might condemn those people who come out and say that, you know, talk about violent acts or even killing homosexuals. But again, the Bible explicitly says that in both the Old and New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, I think all of these things need to be condemned. Not just one or the other, but both of these things are clearly terrorist activities that are inspired by their various religious sects. Now, you might, of course, people are going to dispute interpretations, say, oh, they're taking it out of context. But some of these things, obviously, no context can be, there's no context that can render this, you know, something acceptable.
Well, with the, like the witches, I guess it will say in the Bible, you know, suffer no witch to live. But it really doesn't give any explicit instructions on how to detect a witch, how to tell if a person is a witch. This is something that all the people in Salem decided to make up for themselves. Oh, let's see, we'll put them underwater for a while, and if they drown, then they must be a witch. You know, and all this ridiculous thing, because people were afraid of the boogeyman.
Right. It's what's known as a trial by circumstance, mm-hmm. and it's actually something that is also explicitly endorsed in the Bible. Now, thankfully, we don't have that sort of thing in our legal system, but again, it's a matter of people using religious texts to endorse their horrific acts.
It's a flag they can wave.
Right.
Stand behind it.
Right. And one of the things that... Excuse me, Sam. Sorry.
Studio's very dry.
Yeah. But one of the things that's really troublesome about this is it's really turned a negative eye on the Syrian refugee crisis that has been expanding and now is I think becoming a serious problem that's needed to be resolved for some time. But now the Syrian refugees have been sometimes blamed in some way for the attacks in Paris because France has been very welcoming of the refugees. And people have been trying to claim that somehow they were a shield for the terrorists coming into that country, which is actually kind of ridiculous if you think about it, because, you know, let's look at the September 11th terrorist attack. They managed to come in just to our country just fine without, you know, the shield of refugees.
Yeah.
You know, just coming straight across our north border, you know.
Learn how to fly an airplane, but not learn how to land it.
Right. But a little bit about the Syrian refugees, which is Syria itself has been a country torn apart by war. If ever this civil war ends, I don't think there's going to be much of a country left. Because it's not just Hamas versus the rebels. You also have ISIS in the mix. It's mm-hmm. plus a few other smaller factions. It's a big, messy war where there's not really any safe place in the country to go.
And there's no real answer to it. No one can really win.
Right. That's the problem. I think that's part of why the United States has mostly stayed out of it, is because we don't see any good guys in it.
Well, it's tough, too,
yeah.
to ask... you know, for someone to give up or surrender. But if these people are not in uniform, who is going to surrender? Who's going to say, okay, we give up?
Yeah.
You know, we don't know. We just plain don't know who the enemy is.
Yeah, that's why warfare itself has become a much more complicated matter, because we're dealing with enemies that don't wear uniforms.
Mm-hmm.
But... And again, it's in the roughly five years that it's been going on, there have been somewhere between 140 and 340,000 deaths in Syria. The UN is kind of going with a middle of the road estimate, about 220,000, which, to put that in perspective, that's roughly the same amount lost by the South in the American Civil War. And you have to understand that's, you know, with the American Civil War, you had an entire country, what was then the United States fighting.
I mean, the scope of it was so much larger.
Right. And yet there was, you know, yet Syria has, you know, still a staggering amount of loss, and it's not even that big of a country. Syria itself is about 72,000 square miles, which the state of Pennsylvania is 46,000 square miles.
Hmm.
So we're talking about maybe 1.5 Pennsylvanias. It's really, really not, you know, really not that big of a country, and yet we're still seeing this staggering loss of life, which is which has driven many people out of the country and looking for some place safe to go. But unfortunately, there's been a lot of paranoia about the refugees, which leads to another topic that we'd like to discuss, which is a difficult topic for a lot of people to talk about, and that is Islamophobia. A word that I hope many people can agree has been tossed around way too loosely. And it's often used, it really sometimes really mischaracterizes what it is, what's going on, and the sort of, and I think it's really become,
it's a buzzword, a catchphrase.
Yeah, that's the word I was trying to say. But I think it's important to talk about what it is, and more importantly, what it is not. The idea of, you know, the idea that criticizing Islam as a religion as being Islamophobic is ridiculous. It's not, you know, any ideas are open for criticism, debate, and ridicule, if necessary. And, you know, I think the main point is if it's fair to do it against Christianity, there's no reason it's not fair to do it against Islam.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a fairly decent standard to go by. And I would even go a little bit farther and say, you know, criticizing those who commit horrific acts in the name of their religion is also perfectly acceptable.
Most definitely.
Yeah. And I think it is important to call it out when it is clearly inspired by their religion. Whether or not, you know, again, whether or not you agree with that particular interpretation of the religion is kind of a moot point when it's quite clearly that's where it's coming from.
But it's always the fear of reprisals that scare people. You know, they don't want to speak out against the thing in case the people they're speaking out against, you know, take reprisals against them.
Right, right. And that's the thing. There's a lot of that, too, where it's when you have so much backlash against anybody who will criticize it, both from, you know, both from the Muslim extremists themselves and the people who are trying to, I think, have a rather, what's the right word? I've heard somebody call it a perverted view of tolerance, where it's not, you know, there are some things that should not be tolerated, regardless. But unfortunately, there are some very real cases of Islamophobia. And one thing I want to step back a little bit and say, I was listening to someone, I can't remember, I wish I could remember their name, but it was an interview they did the person doing the interview was from ex-Muslims of North America. And what he said is maybe a good distinction to make is the term Islamophobia and Muslimophobia, where mm-hmm. one refers to the person and one refers to the idea. And, you know, it's important to be on guard that you're not going after the people specifically just because they're a Muslim. You know, now, if they've committed a horrific act in the name of their faith, then yes, that's open for criticism. But just like, you know, we shouldn't personally attack a Christian just because of maybe what other Christians are doing. You know, again, you know, what's fair, what we do with Christianity should be, you know, equally applied to Islam.
Yeah.
Is I think a decent judge. I mean, it's not perfect, but I think it's a decent standard. But but there have been acts where it's obvious that many people in this country, there's a bit of a Muslim hysteria that's going on in this country where, you know, for example, there were protests outside of a mosque in Texas. And not only that, it was an armed protest where people were waving around assault rifles, you know, outside a mosque, and nobody, and they don't know anybody, if anybody in that mosque did anything wrong.
Right.
And that's the problem, is they can't point at anyone there and say, you did this or you did that or you're planning this. they're just out there because of their own paranoid hysteria. And just the other day, Donald Trump came out and said, you know, I think no Muslims should be allowed in this country anymore. Which, you know, even the most, you know, even some of the Republicans that we tend to criticize came out condemning Trump for that. It was that, yeah, I think that was way over the line.
I mean, does he want to deport everyone?
Right. And the worst part is, for me anyway, that is he said it on Pearl Harbor Day, where after the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, America, because of the fear and hysteria surrounding the Japanese in America, they rounded them all up and threw them in camps for the rest of the war.
Big internment camps on the idea that possibly they could sabotage stuff or they could be spies like that. But there were some of them that were Native American. They were born in America, right. Yet they had those strange color shaped eyes, and they didn't look quite the same as us. So therefore, they must be an enemy.
Right. And that's the real problem, that and that's when I think what we really mean, what really we should be talking about when we use the term Islamophobia, is that paranoid hysteria against anyone who identifies as a Muslim is, you know, people just automatically thinking them as a terrorist. There was a comic the other day that's kind of been going around the internet from the TV show Family Guy, where he said, you know, whether they're a when somebody commits a horrific act, whether they're a terrorist or just mentally disturbed, depends on their skin color. And yeah. That was pretty, I think that pretty much nailed it, where, you know, whenever a Muslim commits a terrible act, everybody's ready to jump all over that, saying, oh, it's terrorism. But if it's a Christian who shoots up a Planned Parenthood, they must have been just mentally disturbed.
Mm-hmm. And you notice, too, that the same thing goes for names. If a person's name is Ahmed or Mohammed or anything like that, they almost become an automatic terrorist. I mean, but, you know, what was the name of that? There was this guy that would go around beheading people, cutting their heads off. And they said that this gentleman was either American or an Englishman because he was supposedly born in the country. But, you know, he still had the name, you know, like Ahmed, and people hear that and they go, well, okay, terrorist.
Right.
And it's just become synonymous with it. You look at the latest attack that we've got, those poor people out there in California. Right. The guy was born in the U.S. of A., okay, he was an American citizen, but if you looked at him, you would immediately think, this guy is a terrorist. He looks like the typical sort of Middle Eastern person, and he's got this this name that sounds almost terroristic. So, but it's funny, knowing all that, not one single person was able to say, yeah, he's going to do it, or we can prevent that.
That's one of the reasons I think it's important to call out sort of more domestic terrorism when we see it, just so people understand it's more than just Muslims doing it. Unfortunately, it's terrorism is in general is a problem that faces everybody, all religions, all nationalities, all races, that are capable of producing people who commit terroristic acts.
Well, the news doesn't exactly squash the thing. You know, the media. I mean, they always sensationalize everything. They can get their sound bites in, and if I can get that on the 6 o'clock news.
I mean, unfortunately, American media has become somewhat of a joke. I think that's why we see you see most of the most popular news shows anymore are comedy shows.
Yeah.
You know, and then that's just, I think, a testament to how bad the media has gotten. Although I remember something on The Daily Show a couple days ago, where they were talking about the mosque protests, and they say, you know, how many of the refugees coming here are trying to flee the violence, not bring it with them.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah, and they said... And he showed a picture of someone from ISIS, you know, in a bandana waving a gun, and said, "How would you like to travel thousands of miles to get away from this guy, only to maybe get to Texas and run into this guy?" And he shows the picture of the person outside the mosque, you know, waving around an assault rifle.
Yeah.
And I got into an argument with my dad about this, and one of the things one of the points I was pressing is, you know, we as Americans are capable of doing far worse to ourselves on a daily basis than what I think any refugee coming across our border could do to us.
And we do.
Yeah.
Yeah, every single day.
And another thing I would add to that is, at times, I'm more worried that somebody's going to do something to the refugees than they're going to do something to us. Honestly, I would actually be... It would not surprise me, unfortunately, if that were to happen, where someone, you know, some nutcase, for lack of a better word, just goes out there and starts shooting up a refugee camp.
You know, if I was living over in the Middle East, and you know, I was Middle Eastern, and you know, every day I'd get up in the morning, I'd send my kids to school, you know, I'd have to have a job, buy groceries. And everything, just like a normal person. I don't want war, I don't want strife, I don't want people shooting at me, I just want these radicals to leave me alone. Let me live my life, let me enjoy my my kids, don't involve me in your radicalism. So what would I want to do? I'd want to get out of the country.
Yeah, but unfortunately a lot of people don't have a choice. You know, in many of these theocracies, it's convert or die.
Exactly.
Or, you know, and you're sitting there from a very young age getting programmed to think of it, to approach it this way. So it's in a sense, you know, I'll scorn the leaders, but I definitely feel sorry for a lot of the people living there, just because they're living in these situations and really don't think they have any choice.
Which they don't.
Yeah, and
really.
And that's the thing. And you know, I look at, you know, that kind of, and one thing I would add about the mosque protests is, it's not anything new, unfortunately. You know, even in the weeks following September 11th, mosques were already starting to get vandalized all throughout the country, where it was that people were automatically blaming it, you know, without even stopping to think about, you know, who specifically was doing it.
Yeah.
And it kind of reminds me of, if you look at, say, the early Christians that came to this country, fleeing the religious persecution in Europe, one thing that kind of lost in that discussion is the people doing the persecuting were also Christian.
Yeah.
So,
but it wasn't necessarily their kind of Christianity.
Right. Although sometimes it could be, because you know, a lot of the witch hunts were against their own. There were inter-Protestant wars going on. If you want to get a little bit more specific, I guess you could say, you know, they're kind of Christian. If you wanted, you know, of course you had conflict between the Puritans and the Quakers.
Or between the Catholics and the Protestants.
Right. And it is unfortunate that they actually did bring a lot of that over to America with them. So maybe that's a bad example.
And, yeah.
But, you know, it's... But that's what I look at, is how, you know, how we, looking at history and then looking at the refugees, it feels like so many people have forgotten their own history or don't know what it is. That we're, you know, as they say, people who don't know history are doomed to repeat it. And that's what I see a lot of going on here, is this hysteria towards the Syrian refugees is looking very eerily similar to the hysteria regarding, you know, the Japanese during World War II, and, you know, any other group that America has had a paranoia against at some point in our history.
Well, it was also in England during the Second World War. There was definite hatred toward the Germans.
Man.
I mean, you know, you were best not seen being talking to a German, because they were obviously evil, and they were obviously the enemy.
And you also have really throughout history, people have had this odd paranoia of Jewish people since the time of the Crusades.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the anti-Semitism was really founded out of nothing, but, you know, of course, well, I should say it was founded out of what they believed, out of what the Gospels were saying about the Jewish people.
Which, you know, had an ulterior motive there.
Right.
Yeah.
But, I mean, even today, there is still a lot of anti-Semitism in this country.
Oh, enormous.
Yeah, and I think they're one of the biggest targets for hate crimes still. Mm-hmm. And there's no reason at all that should happen. But people come, there's just this hysteria mindset that's still there. And we really can't let that go.
But isn't it kind of tough, though, to shake off the things that you were brought up to believe,
the hatred
that has been handed down to you all this time, and you kind of accept what your parents say and your friends say as being the truth, even though it's a lie. So the hatred is just passed on, and the distrust, it's just never ending.
Oh yeah, I mean I totally agree with that, and I've had my fair share of that in my own life, where since the time I began identifying as an atheist, I've felt myself just having to reevaluate everything I ever thought.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I shudder at the things I thought and did and said 10 years ago. You know, it seemed perfectly normal and natural things to say back then, but now I realize how wrong they were. And I look at that and I'm like, and I wasn't even that deeply indoctrinated compared to some other people. You know, I can't even imagine how hard it is to throw off that. If you're in an environment where it's 100% surrounded by it, and not only that, if you don't believe it, you're going to die.
But you were extremely well educated, and you were well read, which is the important thing.
Right, and I think that's, you know, and I think, yeah, that's the thing. It's the best way to combat ignorance is education, always.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean that's. And the best, actually, education can help help you out of a lot of things. I think it was Frederick Douglass, who was one of the most famous runaway slaves ever, was saying he realized how he could get out of slavery when he saw a slave owner yelling at somebody for educating the slaves. He was like, mm-hmm. this is how we get out.
Yeah, and didn't he also say that I used to pray for freedom, and then one day I prayed with my feet, and he left.
Right. So I mean, it's now. I should say, as a positive note, it's easy to look at these things and get pessimistic about them, and, you know, about the world and how we have all of these attacks going on and all these horrible things going on. But there's always a good story if you look hard enough. For example, the night of the terrorist attacks in Paris, at one point, all the cab drivers just started to stop charging people and just started giving people free rides to get home. Mm-hmm. People started lining up to donate blood. Some people were opening up their houses to help to let other people in if they needed to spend the night. I mean, it was all just spontaneous, just people wanting to help. And, you know, in the wake of the Oklahoma City bombing, there were, you know, it was two people, it was committed by two people, but there were hundreds of people there ready to help out, you know, to comfort the grieving, to rescue those still trapped in the building.
That actually walked into the gunfire to help other people rather than away from it.
Right, yeah, and in various other situations there. You know, it was a talk that Seth Andrews gave recently where he went over that, where it was, you know, for every act of a horrific act like this, there are, you know, countless more acts of kindness by people in the wake of these tragedies. And there is, there is a lot of good, you know, a lot of good news to take out of this, actually. The Muslims have been becoming more vocal towards their protests of ISIS, mm-hmm. or even Al-Qaeda, like in the wake of when Malala got shot for having the audacity to want to be educated. Mm-hmm. A lot of people started to, there was actually a pretty big backlash against Al-Qaeda for doing that. Mm-hmm. By their fellow Muslims, to the point it was almost a PR disaster for them.
But isn't it funny that now everyone was afraid of Al-Qaeda.
Right.
You know, it that was the terrorist group.
Right.
Now you almost don't hear about it anymore. They're still there, still doing the things, but ISIS is so much worse.
Right. But still, the worse they become, the more vocal Muslims have been towards their opposition of them.
Yeah.
Which is starting to get them some notice, which will hopefully empower more people to speak out against them, and you know, and so on, and hopefully, it's hopefully something to build on. And I remember something that Aaron Raw once said, where he said, you know, the more radical the lunatic fringe, the more mainstream the objection becomes.
The thing is, how many people have got to speak out? You know,
right, and I think it's important for us to bring attention to that, though, that there are people out there ready to speak out, ready to fight against this, the more radical elements of their particular group.
But they've got to be peaceful protests against them. I mean, it doesn't do any good saying we protest against ISIS and then go march down Main Street and burn cars and businesses.
Right, and on the other side of it, you know, as I already said, the Republicans everywhere the Republican leaders are condemning Donald Trump for his hateful statements. There was also a counter protest in Texas in the wake of the mosque protest. People counter protested against the bigotry of that protest, and which was actually was a very encouraging sign to see that sort of welcoming and saying, you know, these people do not represent us.
I think the best thing, though, the police can do is not try to break up protests, but opposing protest, keep the two apart, keep the peace. Let them shout at each other from across the street like that, but no one's going to walk across the street to attack the other people.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's some of this is you let it go on, you give them publicity just to show people how bad they look, mm-hmm. and some of that is necessary, which is because that leaves people like, well, I don't believe that, you know, I don't agree with them. It can make people uncomfortable, you know, thinking the same way, but seeing people take it to that extreme can get people to start rethinking how they approach it.
and you know how they themselves think.
Right, and that can be a powerful tool sometimes. As a couple of people who have come out of Christianity have said, sometimes it wasn't the atheist arguments, it was seeing how bad Christianity was being defended that made them finally come out of religion. In fact, that was part of my own deconversion too, was just seeing the disconnect between, you know, things that were being practiced and things that were being preached, and feeling dissatisfied with the hypocrisy in the church is what really started to make me question a lot of things. Well, I mean, obviously I eventually moved beyond that into more intellectual arguments, but that is at least something to get people to kind of take a step back and rethink what they believe and how they feel about certain issues. But I think that's about all I have to say on that for the time being. Obviously, it's a vast, complicated subject that's gonna keep going for a while. But I think there is hope that it will improve. At least you got to hold on to it.
Yeah.
It may be a little full-hearted, but I think you just have to do it or you drown in pessimism. And when you start getting pessimistic about it, it's pretty much over at that point. You just letting it go won't help anything.
Yeah. Well, you know, just to change horses there, but a simile of that was that I used to work in a nightclub. Okay, I took care of the door and worked slow bar like that. And it was interesting to go in there and remain totally sober, never having a drink, never taking any drugs, and watch people walk in and see them slowly get plastered or high, and listen to what they were saying and the way they were acting, and thinking that they were cool, that this is the way that everyone should act. They were having such a good time, but they were an entirely different person than the person that came in. And I think a lot of these people that are prejudiced with, you know, Islamophobia and everything, don't really know what they're acting like. They're thinking that they're having a good time, right, that their ideas are acceptable to everyone else, and they got distorted views.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's when I started changing my mind about a lot of things, you know, When I used to think these things or say these things, I mostly did it because I never thought about it.
Mm-hmm.
Literally, I wouldn't think about them. They just seemed okay. But then when I went away to college and started getting exposed to other ideas, and it wasn't so much just directly, there weren't as that many direct challenges. It was just being exposed to different ideas and different modes of thought that got me to start considering it. And eventually, it just one by one, things started to change.
Well, roads opened up for you. Before, right, you were marching down one main highway,
right,
and then all of a sudden you get down there and you start thinking and you say, "Gee, here's a lot of detours here. Let's see what it's like down this one. Let's see what it's like down that one." And that's why education is so important, because it opens your mind, it helps fight prejudice.
Right. And then there's also, you might talk about Muslims one way, but it's going to be very different if you actually meet one.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that was the way I was when I went away to college, is when you start meeting the people you were prejudiced against, the prejudice starts to go away,
mm-hmm,
at least if you're open-minded enough, unfortunately. Sometimes it can reinforce it, but other times it's just you start to hang out with someone like that, and you're like, oh, maybe they're not how I thought they were.
Yeah, and, just and like I, you. They like the same things. They love their kids. They do everything the same.
As they say, how many minds were changed about gay people when they started coming out of the closet?
Mm-hmm.
Because then you realize everybody knows a gay person. Why am I vilifying these people? There's you realize all the stereotypes and all the vilification is completely unfounded. And the shift in the attitude towards homosexuals has changed dramatically in the last couple of decades. It's been a complete cultural shift.
Well, as the younger generation has propelled that forward, that's the whole point. I mean, old codgers like me of my age, they probably still got a slight degree of prejudice within them, although I make a conscious effort to not be prejudiced, and I go out of my way to try and be nice to everyone, except someone tells me that I'm going to hell, like that, then my attitude will change. But it's the younger people that are changing the attitudes, the morals of society, which is a good thing.
Yeah, and hopefully it will continue, hopefully we'll have these discussions less and less. One can always hope, can't we?
Yeah. As soon as us old codgers die off, it'll be a better world.
Can we hurry that up a little bit? I'm just kidding. But anyway, let's end on a slightly lighter note. We got 15 minutes. Another thing I wanted to talk a little bit about was with the upcoming of Christmas. One thing I recently got into a discussion with somebody, a family member, about some of the contradictory accounts of the birth narrative of Jesus you find in the first two chapters of Luke and Matthew, and I talked a little bit about how contradictory they were, but I was making a write up of it. And it was kind of funny because writing it up, it made me just see it, just how bad it was and how these two stories, like one in Matthew and one in Luke, are so different that if you took the names out of the story, you wouldn't know they're talking about the same person.
Mm-hmm.
And here's just like a bit of a rundown of all the things I was looking at. But, that are difference between the two stories. One thing you'll notice that is the account in Matthew is a lot darker than the one in Luke. Like there's in Matthew there's an attempt on his life. Everybody's all of Jerusalem is troubled by the news of his birth. But in Luke there's basically all sorts of joyous celebration surrounding his birth, and they take him to the temple as a newborn, and there are people there to welcome him. Then of one major contradiction is when was he born? Because in Matthew they say he was born under Herod the Great, who died in 4 BC, but in Luke he talks about when Quirinius was governor of Syria, which didn't happen until 6 AD. So there's a gap of 10 years at very least. Now, there have been all sorts of apologetics to try to deal with this. They'll try to say that Quirinius might have been a two-term governor or all these different things, but they're really just speculation with no evidence to them and actually a lot of evidence against them. But one of the things none of these explanations can reconcile is the census, which actually there was no worldwide census at that point. There was one decades later. Now, there was probably a local one in 6 AD, because that's actually, in 6 AD is when Judea got annexed to Syria, and they probably would have conducted a census of the area.
Well, that was related to taxes. They want to know who they could tax.
Right, right. And what probably happened is Luke just got those two things mixed up. And again, that wouldn't have happened until 6 AD. And there's no way that in the Roman Empire wouldn't have had jurisdiction to issue that census beforehand. So it's like this is irreconcilable.
Differences, yeah.
Yeah. And then you'll also hear sometimes about, you know, Matthew, he has the angel appear to Joseph to tell him that, you know, Mary's about to give birth. And it's funny because in that quote, he actually quotes Isaiah, the angel talking to Joseph quotes Isaiah 7:14, which is like, unto you is born a child, you know, will be born of a virgin, etc. Mm-hmm. Now, we could split hairs over whether or not virgin is the correct translation. But the more interesting thing about it is that Isaiah 7:14 was not talking about Jesus. So he has an angel quoting Isaiah 7:14 as if it's a prophecy, which it isn't. Like, the child in question in Isaiah was actually supposed to be assigned to the people standing right in front of Isaiah 700 years before the time of Jesus. And in fact, if you read in Isaiah 8, the child is actually Isaiah's own son.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, there's absolutely no way, you know, that's a big gaffe that that Matthew made.
Well, I mean, everything is romanticized, you know, with the Bible accounts. Because one of my favorites is when they were talking about the shepherds watching their flocks by night,
right. Okay,
keeping guard on them. Well, in December, out in the Middle East, it is cold. I used to live there, and there's no shepherd that's going to be sitting outside on a rock watching his sheep. They would have brought them into a corral, and he would have been in a warm house. So it was kind of romanticized, the whole thing. Yeah. And also puts it out upon the accredited date of Jesus' birth.
Right, right. And most people don't even realize that December 25th was a later addition. It wasn't. I mean, it wasn't part of Christianity for hundreds of years after, until 100 years after.
No, it was intermingled with paganism. And,
right. But there's one other major gaffe by Matthew as far as prophecies go in the birth narrative, and that's in when he talks about Mary and Joseph returning to Nazareth, or mm-hmm. going to Nazareth. In Luke, they already live in Nazareth at the beginning of the story, but in Matthew, they don't go there until after Jesus is born.
Mm-hmm.
But there's also a point where he talks about Jesus living in Nazareth is supposed to be a fulfillment of some prophecy that he would be a Nazarian. There's two problems with this passage. The first is Nazarian doesn't mean someone who's from Nazareth. It's referring to a specific moral code.
Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, okay. Yeah,
or a moral code or possibly a Jewish sect. Mm-hmm. There's a little debate about it, but I think most of the time it's usually referring to a moral code.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, abstaining from sex, you know, all sorts of other things that, because actually the book of Acts describes followers of Jesus as Nazareans.
Mm-hmm.
There's an even more interesting part about that passage that is often overlooked, and that is the prophecy appears nowhere in the Old Testament. It appears to be part of a scripture that we no longer have,
mm-hmm.
which really throws into question, you know, whether this is divinely inspired when you're citing prophecies that no one bothered to put in the actual Bible. I mean, and the list just goes on to on.
But was it really in the original Torah?
It's hard to say because
Old Testament.
It's hard to say because the Hebrew people didn't actually canonize their own scriptures until much later,
mm-hmm.
and there was still a lot of dispute, and we know different Jewish sects were using different books as scripture, and that's one of the things that's often overlooked when we discuss this is. A lot of apologists kind of gloss over the fact that Judaism was pretty badly divided at this point. It was as divided as Christianity is today.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, not quite to thousands of sects, but there were at least, we know of at least 10 different sects in existence at the time of Jesus, and there may have been as many as 30.
And don't forget, originally, nothing, as they say, was ever written down. These stories were taught to their children and to the young people verbatim, and they were handed down verbally. Man. So, you know, the old game, you know, you tell a story to the first person, yeah. And by the time you get to the 10th, it's nowhere near. Well, even though they were very, very strict on trying to be precise to the story, you can't tell me that over a few hundreds of years or thousands of years that the story didn't change.
Well, I would actually dispute some of the assertions made about the oral tradition, because there are times that I think the oral tradition is just made up by apologists. Well, I mean, I'm not saying there was no oral tradition, but there were a lot of books when they were originally written down were not part of oral tradition. They were original composition. In fact, we see several times throughout the Bible where different prophets are complaining about people tampering with the Bible, with mm-hmm. the scriptures. And actually, Jeremiah, he explicitly says, like, you know, you think you're wise by the law, but the false pen of scribes has turned it into a lie. So there's obviously was a lot of forgery going on. And most of the oral tradition, I think, was kept within the priesthood. And of course, the priests were kind of at the will of the king in charge, who sometimes, like, you can actually check, there's actually portions of the Bible that have been obviously edited mm-hmm. by a king trying to make himself look better.
No, don't forget, I mean, the Pharisees, really, they ruled the behest of the king, too. So, you know, they even though they were Jewish priests, they still had to kind of toe the line and the official word of the throne.
Well, yeah, although that kind of started to change after the Roman occupation, mm-hmm. and it kind of, but yeah, I guess my point is the way these stories were passed down is a lot messier than what anybody really knows.
Mm-hmm. Well, we touched on that for a few free thought forums beforehand, and all the forgeries that were in the Bible.
Yeah, and that's the thing. And I would also point out there's obviously also times in these birth narratives where they're taking from other portions of the Bible or other scriptures. For example, the flight to Egypt in Matthew was most likely meant to echo the story of Moses mm-hmm. coming out of Egypt, or just, you know, generally the Exodus in general. There's also a rather peculiar, in Luke they have what's known as Mary's song, but it's actually a rewrite of Hannah's song from Genesis. Mm-hmm. And there's also a rather peculiar feature in the Gospel of Luke, and that is the birth narrative of John the Baptist is actually much longer than Jesus. Mm-hmm. And you can actually edit out that part, and you come up with a story that was probably originally taken from material from the John the Baptist cult. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were probably rewriting scriptures of other cults to form their own. Yeah. But that's about all the time we have. We've got to start winding down here.
And don't forget that our next show, we're going to have a little history lesson about our founding fathers and everything, and deism. And what it is. So, and this was a professionally prepared show. So, we hope that you'll tune in then, and because it will be pre-recorded, so there's no phone calls.